start with the roll call. Is Eric?
Present.
Is Emkin?
Yep.
Is Hubbard?
Present.
Mr. Jacobs?
Present.
Dr. Sophia? Mr. Marshall?
Here.
Ms. Mendelson?
Here.
Mr. Newman?
Here.
Dr. O'Donnell?
Here.
Ms. Shereen?
Here.
Dr. Smith?
Here.
Ms. Spencer? Mr. James?
Present.
We have a...
Thank you. Let's have a pledge of allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, before we get started, because this is a pretty large room, I'm asking everyone if we can talk louder than we normally do. Some of you will be fine. I know I have to talk louder, and if you can't hear me, just let me know, and we'll speak up. We have on the agenda a lot of issues, so we're going to move through them. There is one main issue that we're primarily going to be discussing, but there's a couple before that as well. And let's start off with reviewing and adoption of the minutes. We have typo correction in September 18th minutes of this year. Is that in front of us?
It's in the packet.
In the packet. And do we have a motion to approve these minutes?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Motion carried. Adoption of the second draft of the October 16 minutes. There's a motion.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Not in favor? Okay, so moved. Adoption of the November 20th, 2014 minutes. Motion.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Not in favor? So moved. Okay. With that, we'll have the first call to the audience. Yeah. Since we have the luxury of a podium, why don't we come up and use it? We don't have to if you really don't want to, but you can use the podium. Tiffany Rose will be the first one.
Examines the dog that can possibly confirm or not
and the animal's pregnant. Vet memos are the results of his or her exam. If unable to confirm pregnancy through exam, then proceed as normal based upon overall health and behavior assessment of the animal. If the animal is being spayed and found pregnant after surgery begins, surgery will proceed. If pregnancy is confirmed, then proceed with the pleas to the New Hope partners. Alternative placement sends out 3 email pleas, 3 days in a row. Ideally, a group will take the pregnant animal. If there is no response to our pleas, New Hope the animal, then we will proceed with the best outcome we can make for each animal with the approval of our director. We have found that by working with our New Hope partners and accommodating the request to not terminate pregnancies has led to all of us working together better than everyone being cognizant of informity and the dilemma of so many pregnant animals. So they will give the option of networking an animal that's found to be obviously pregnant, and then if there is no rescue group to take them, they will spay abort. And they have found that changing their policy from spay aborting everything to going this way has improved their relationship with partnered rescues. I also have one from Pinal County, which is in Casa Grande, and I'm having a hard time finding it right now, but basically it, do you have it? But basically it's the same thing. They network, and if there's no options for the animals, then they are spay aborted.
No, they are not. They allow the babies to be born at the shelter.
If you want to speak, fill out one of these.
Sorry. So we'll have her fill that out and we'll address all now. But Maricopa is a huge shelter in a huge community, and they're working with their rescue partners instead of just shutting them down and saying, you know what, you might have options, but we're going to choose to kill instead. So I would hope that PAC, with all the advancements and support that they have, would try and open up their relationships and keep them open. A year ago, this wasn't an issue, but it is now.
Thank you. James Dean.
My name is James Dean. I've been a volunteer since the early part of January this year. My wife and I both volunteer at PAC. During that time, I just figured it out that my wife and I have put in together over 1,100 hours, which, as Kristen would say, is a half a full-time employee. So my wife and I are there quite often. What I came today is to talk about the new PAC policy of allowing a dog that has tick fever to only have meds for a month. After that, it's put into a short-term rescue. I like to have a handout. I only have one handout. You can pass that. This is Shorty. Shorty's a dog that came into PAC on April 18th as part of a horde. There was 40 cats, 33, and 33 dogs. Shorty had tick fever. It makes me very sad to think that with PAC's new policy, Shorty would have been put down in late May. As it is, we pulled him with the help of Tucson Colwet Noses on May 18th, or I'm sorry, on June 6th. So after that, we Colwet Noses paid for his meds. And since then, he's been cured. Shorty had a very high titer. His titer is over 20,000. He was on meds for a month and a half. And when we took him to the doctor for blood test, his titer was down to, as the doctor called it, negligible. It was very low. I say it makes me sad to know that he could have been put down, but I do. What makes me feel better is I know that there's a lot of rescue groups out there who would have pulled Shorty. I know Tucson Colwet Noses, I would assume Arms of Angels, or other groups would have pulled him. don't like the way that the dogs go to short-term rescue. I've talked to staff members and they tell me that, and it seems to work sometimes, that this is a vehicle to get the dogs out in the public awareness so that it makes them easier, makes them more guaranteed to be adopted. I understand what they're doing, but I think PAC is playing Russian roulette with the lives of these animals, and I'm concerned about that. And I would just like to, suggest that PAC rethink their process of the 1 month for the tick fever. And another thing off the subject of that is, I recently heard some disparaging comments about Dr. Wilcox. I'd like to tell everyone I had nothing but greatest admiration for Dr. Wilcox. In fact, I call her Ann Sullivan because she's a miracle. That's it.
Thank you, Mr. Dean. Justin Pope.
Mr. Chair, members of the committee, thank you for helping me to speak to you today. I'm a numbers guy. In my career, I work with cattle on a daily basis. I was very, concerned with the data which was presented by Dr. Garcia in the November meeting of this board. I have a handout here of the charts that were presented along with my own presentation of the same data. The first error I noticed is that the intake line on the top left chart is in a separate truncated axis, meaning that that axis doesn't start at zero. This has the effect of making the slope of this line appear misleadingly high and visually exaggerates the extent to which intake has fallen in proportion to the increase in adoptions. Second, on this same chart, there is an adoptions total bar and an SNA bar above that. This is confusing to me. Implies that the special needs adoptions would be included in the adoptions total, which means that they're double counted when showing as a separate bar stacked on top of that total. This again makes it appear the adoptions are increasing even faster than they actually are. On the top right, you can see what these numbers would look like with these errors corrected. Third, there's another chart that was provided last month that gave further details about rescues. It indicated that there were 55 rescue partners in 2010 with 2,113 animals rescued for an average of 19. However, simple mathematics will tell you that the average ought to be 38, and that's true all the way through this table. I have concerns about the validity of this data when the few pieces that are verifiable have such obvious errors. Finally, it was emphasized that rescue pulls are down over a period of time while special needs adoptions are up. While this claim was true, for 2012 to 2013, where regular adoptions were only slightly up over the prior year, the truth is that both rescue and special needs adoptions have fallen in 2013 to 2014. In fact, SNAs are down 15% from last year, which is a higher percentage fall than the intake numbers over that same period of time. This does not support the claim that SNAs are the answer to or the cause of reduced rescue rates. Other than one data point over 4 years, there was no correlation. Further, in the year ending 2013, rescue pulls were still slightly higher than the 2011 levels, despite fewer intakes and higher special needs adoptions. Why then have both rates fallen in the past year, and rescues significantly so, while regular adoptions have increased? Have there been changes since mid-2013 that would be affecting both of these programs specifically? I think this is the kind of question that should be asked rather than creating arbitrary restrictions on which kinds of animals that reputable private rescues can devote their private funding and resources towards. Please keep this in mind when considering the opinions that were expressed last month by Dr. Garcia and PAC management using this data for their support. If we as a county are going to look at the life and death of homeless pets from the big picture perspective, that picture must be clear and in focus. Thank you again for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Bell. Karen, hold.
Thank you very much for letting me speak this month. At the last advisory committee meeting, Dr. Garcia spoke about how we as a community need to look at the big picture and how special needs adoptions that PAC has done in the last year are impactful and make a difference. These special needs adoptions do make a difference and would not happen at all if it were not for the volunteers and rescue community networking those animals. Jose Ocaño, I'm sorry if I pronounced that wrong, also spoke at a recent meeting of PAC volunteers about having to consider the big picture when making life or death decisions about individual animals. The big picture and making the largest benefit for the majority of animals is what volunteers and rescue partners keep in mind every day. Many of us are working in rescue. We spend hours and days of our lives educating the community about vaccination, spaying and neutering pets, normal animal behavior, and training. We have the same goals for the community's animals as the health department does. It is true that each rescue has their own specialized interests and concerns that brought them to the calling of this community service. Some, like me, focus on pregnant animals and nursing mothers. Others are interested in helping seniors, and others are called to care for specific breeds or conditions. Many have spoken about the lack of communication from PAC employees to rescues to allow them time to network dogs or cats that meet their specific interests before irrevocable changes are made. Alienating your rescue partners is not beneficial to the big picture of saving the most animals and educating the community about responsible pet ownership. The system is broken. Imagine how much of an impact we could make as a community, how many more lives could be saved if only the health department could put their focus on fixing the system's problem instead of denying a problem exists. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Paul. That ends the call to the audience. We'll move on to the manager's report. Mr. James.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and members of the committee. I'll try not to take up too much time, as we do have a full agenda, as you mentioned. We have the first bulleted item on the agenda indicates a report or a memorandum from the county administration in reference to legal opinion on dog animal care services in city and towns. Real quickly, the cities and towns are 6% of the service provided by the animal care center. So we're 6% of the business that PACC performs is for contracted cities and towns. So they are a key player in any discussion we have. Currently, cities and towns staff are struggling with the budget increase this year and providing and going the direction the county has chosen to go. County administrator, in this memorandum, in addition to others, made very clear the county is not changing the direction course of the Pima Care Center. However, we still need to have a discussion with the city and town on how it will all continue moving forward, especially in their jurisdictional area. And they're solely responsible for animal care in their jurisdictional area. It is not a county responsibility to do the things that we do for the cities and towns, what the animal care center does for the cities and towns and the cities and towns. It's the cities and towns' responsibilities, and it will be their decision on where they go with that. We're hoping to move them in this direction to help find the right mix of financial and other resourcing to help them continue on this course as the county is set and will remain. So we want you to be aware of that. Discussion is ongoing, and we're hopeful that we can find the right place so that they're comfortable with continuing the budget and fund and resource our animal services in the direction the county has chosen to go.
Okay. 1 second. The very last sentence is their what? Say that again, the last sentence.
Well, I'd have to have that.
Okay, so you said they're in agreement with you to continue to what we're doing now?
No, they're not. We're in discussions to find a way so that we can all move in the same path.
I see.
I rephrase that. I obviously didn't say
something. No, I just got something.
So to answer your question, they are not in agreement at this point, only because they don't know how to make the finances work. We're helping them with that, and we're hoping to get there sooner than later. The second item is a memorandum to the committee in relation to answers from last month's meeting, a memorandum from myself to the committee. In addition, it added a request, in essence, by the Temple of Arizona. still be able to have a member on this committee. As you recall, the committee made a motion and passed that motion to have that position removed. Currently working on an ordinance with Commissioner Reen that includes that ordinance change provision to eliminate that position from the committee. However, I will have to ask that, I want to put that on the table for the committee's consideration. Not necessarily for this meeting, because it wasn't agendized, but for possibly future discussion. And or committee vote in that direction, you know, the state, of course, that's, of course, just want you aware that I have to have that. There's a draft Senate bill in there to show some of the things that are going on from Maricopa County's perspective on licensing and vaccination. They're not looking to change the licensing requirements and vaccination requirements. Much of it has to do with the violation or the sentence that the person would be given if they're found in violation of licensing versus vaccination. Currently, if a person has in the state statute, has a pet that is not vaccinated or licensed, it's a class 2 misdemeanor violation. This ordinance would change a licensing violation to a petty offense. So that if you got vaccinated, you keep it vaccinated, but you don't get a license, you're not going to have something on a criminal record that would cause problems with future employment and other things. So that's the main point of that, but there are a couple of minor things in there. Of course, you have the operation report for month of November and year to date. And new building timeline. Basically, by next summer, we hope to have the planning phase done, and by October, by October of 2017, have the building done. That's our generalization.
2017?
By October 2017, have the building built. So, planning phase till 10, 12 months, well, actually 18 months from now, and another 18 by the end. That concludes my report, Secretary.
There was one replies to the animal welfare questions from the November 20th meeting. Do you have any update on that, on those welfare cases that we were asking about, particularly on that?
They're in the management report. They're in the record. For the animal welfare, yes. One of them, thank you for that, Mr. Chairman of the committee. The case that included an owner that received a pet back, and the committee asked for a recheck. That recheck was completed on 12-8. The shelter is now a large, clean shed with water. It's a 12-year-old dog. It appeared healthy when the officer was there, so we did go back to sign out and found everything in order.
Is that
good?
Yeah.
It is, sir.
Great. Thank you. Okay. Any questions on the report for the committee? Yes, Mr. Jenkins.
Will we get a report next month on the attempt to find the owner in the case of Evan 43?
Right, Mr. Jacobs had that was a question that was from the month before, where there was an owner that the dog went back to, not actually, they went back to the owner, and then they said that the dog was with the mother or something, and we said, well, you just can't, you know, do a shuffle of a dog like that. Where's the dog? And so that was one of the questions. I mean, there was Goofy that came after that. That was the second one. And then there was the first one, which I believe you were involved.
That wasn't the case on the
physical. Well, it's not on now, but it was something that was going to be a follow-up. That was exactly what you're talking about, right?
Well, and they followed up and said they attempted it, but they couldn't find a new address. That's what I'm reading here.
That's correct.
Yeah, my question is, will it be further attempts? Or what's the policy? And if there are further attempts, when we get a report? It's a matter of curious as to if this situation arises, what happens? Mm-hmm. You know, what's the policy? What's the procedures? And so, the question would be: will this question regarding the case still be on the agenda for next time, or is it completed by no action?
No, it is on the agenda until it's completed. At least in my opinion, we've kept old items on the agenda until they're actually completed. But the question on that particular issue was, the dog went back to the people that originally had it. Something was, it was sick or something like that. And then they said, well, now it's somewhere else. And we don't really know where that person is. It was their mother, I believe, mother-in-law. But so, at least from my perspective, if the dog came back to me and I moved it somewhere else, I'm still responsible for that dog, not wherever it is that I put it. And so just the fact that that person is saying, I don't know where the dog is now. Like, I mean, it could be buried in the backyard for all we know. But the point is, they initially had the dog. You can't just pawn it off and say, well, now it's with my mother and she says he's fine. Because I don't know the dog's fine. Yeah, they need to be able, exactly, they need to be able to show the dog so that we can see, I mean, the enforcement should be able to see that dog.
Mr. Chair, members of the committee, we are concerned about these pets, but when we run out of leads and clues and there's nowhere else to go and they are not willing to tell us things, there's no way we can force that.
What about citing?
They are already been cited, and they will be given, and they will go to court, and they will be held accountable for the things that they did.
I see.
But there's no further, we can't trace that down at this point.
Okay. I wasn't aware that they were cited, and that they have to go to court, because they're still responsible for that job.
Well, any previous action that we found in violation, they are cited, and they will go to court for those. But once we go back to recheck and or to follow up, and the animal has been transferred to another owner, in-law, whether it's a member of their family or not, there's only so much we can do until we run into that again, or they're willing to give us information.
Okay, so let's say that the initial recheck was as a result of a certain amount of things that they were doing wrong. And we know that if the dog went back to that and it wasn't rechecked, it could get worse. And then we're trying to look for the dog. Wouldn't they be held responsible for the subsequent medical deterioration of the dog? We can just assume it's dead, right?
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, that is a tough legal question that we would have to ask. It would be the way our closure is and the animal's care would be subject to who was taking care of at the time we find it in their hand. So it would not be any previous owner's responsibility.
Ms. Sanchez.
Can we make a request of the court, because this person is going to court, can we make a request that they have to provide documentation where the animal is? For a recheck.
We'd make requests like that under the court, Ms. Truman, and we could make those kinds of requests and see what the court does with it. Now, it may be too late for this one because these court things happen pretty quickly. The hearing happens within 2 weeks of the citation, the initial hearing, and then the initial court case may happen within another month or two of these types of cases. So, but we can certainly consider that as we continue to respond to these kinds of cases.
Okay, I have no more questions on that. Does anyone have any more questions on the report, the manager's report, the three items there? Okay, I'm going to move to the old business, and there's a few that I'm going to touch on rather than all of them, because I wanted to move into the rescue issue. And then I'll kind of get to the ground rules on the rescue issue, how we're going to actually think about the the one I wanted to touch on was Mr. Derek brought this up, and it's an issue, Mr. Marshall, has to do with vet holds and confiscations, and I'll leave it up to you now.
Sure. Looking over the agenda, I saw old business vet holds and confiscation holds. I also saw my Facebook at the same time. There were some volunteers talking about a dog named Roger. Roger is a year and a half old, or was a year and a half old when he came to PAC on January 30th. Of 2014, so he's going on his anniversary being at PAC. But if you wanted to adopt Roger, you'd see him on Pat Harbor website. Here he is, he's ready to be adopted, just come on down and meet him. But apparently he lives in Dr. Lilly's office, and I didn't know who would know that. Some volunteers, they play a little game, I don't think they really play it, but where's Roger? Because they can't seem to locate him. Most of the staff they ask will say they never heard of him or there's no dog back there. But this particular volunteer who I talked to via email, he's found him a few times, and he lives in Dr. Lilly's office. But if Roger was to get adopted, would the adopter go up and say, I need to get to Dr. Lilly's office? Where is Dr. Lilly's office? Because they've checked in to see him a few times. Sometimes they're told, you can't come back here, you can't see him, he's behind a locked door. Sometimes they're being told he's not there. and they've met with him a few times, but, you know, I don't want to focus on just one dog situation, even though Roger, after a year, probably deserves a home. But there's probably some systemic issue of communication and how do we get that dog out there so it could get adopted. Because I was surprised to see it on the website. I figured it was probably a hold for some criminal investigation or something to be locked up like that, or a severely sick dog. But I couldn't find any information saying it was sick or that it's a part of a case. It's not on our hold list. There's six dogs right now on the hold list. I didn't see it on there. So where's Roger?
Members of the committee, excellent points. And we certainly dig into all the reasons Roger was being cared for and monitored in the clinic. Generally, it is a case of an injury, illness that needs significant amount of work to rehabilitate him. And now he's available. And that is some indication in a few of the welfare, especially the severe welfare cases we deal with. But I would just with staff on how we can better answer your question of what's taking the animals so long to become available, what's happening with them. So we know, these are reasons. This needs to be done, and we're comfortable. We want this to happen this way. And if we preach to the system, we can make it. But with those kinds of cases, you're aware of the number of animals that have been in the shelter for a time and aren't being available, what's up with that, as opposed to using this whole report. So we need to revamp that and fix that and present it possibly a different, an improved version of this report so that we can do that. And if there are animals, if not those animals that are to be used in the staff, how those animals are to be made available as quickly as possible, foster programs that are have cared for in a place other than the shelter. Or if the shelter's the right answer, it's all on the table and we'll know.
Well, the concern I have with that is that, not with what you said, but the one thing that hasn't been said, is that this report was designed so that we would know where the dogs are, I mean, who's being held, and for what reason. And when you end up having a report that already now shows that dog wasn't on the report and hasn't been on some for a while, it speaks to the credibility of the report. And because the very next question I have is, well, wait a minute, how many other dogs are on this report? And so, can we look at that?
Absolutely. Yes, Mr. Chairman, in my poor way, that's exactly what I was
saying. Okay. Thank you, I appreciate it.
Could you talk a little louder, please?
Yes.
Sure. All of us or just me?
Everybody.
All right. We will do that. There is one issue that I'll always ask about, and that is like an update. Now, those 22 items, like I indicated before, when I first brought that up, that was written up 10, 15 minutes before I came down the pack. So I'm going to add more than 22, so I'll give them to you. We'll call it the 22 items, even though there'll be 122. But nonetheless, can I get an update on that? Because that's part of the old business, is where we're at with those, like the feeding of the dogs with all the other dogs, and there was a whole bunch of things in there.
Yeah, so.
I'm sorry, Mr. James, I was addressing it to him. I'll address it to you.
Mr. Chairman, if you have to, I think you have to define your address directly to the staff, and I'll yield to their experience and their direction for the moment.
Thank you.
So we're still making the same progress with the new inmate program. We're still getting our footing. We have seen a lot of changes, though, with the women being much more compassionate. There's more of them. There's more extended hours. So we still are. The one challenge we're having, we knew we were going to have this challenge with the inmate program, is these are county inmates, which means they're not sentenced for a long period of time. So the turnover rate is higher. So right now we're trying to really solidify a really solid training and identify which inmates are there who are there for longer periods of time, and butting them up with brand new inmates, and then having the COs and the custodial people training them. We anticipate around mid-February that we'll actually have our supervisor on the floor. We've actually had a lot of changes we're moving a lot of different things with now taking over the clinic and moving the clinic supervisor to the shelter so that we have four. We've had a demotion of a supervisor. They voluntarily demoted themselves as of this week.
And so that really changes the dynamic of now we're going to open up a supervisor position, so it's kind of postponed things a little bit. But for the most part, it's a work in progress and the same from last meeting.
Okay, so on this, you've read it, I'm assuming.
Yeah.
So there's things like, when you're addressing that with the inmates, are you talking that they're the ones going to be handling, like they're going to come up with a solution and they're possibly trying to feed dogs?
No, it's our shelter supervisors working with their supervisors, since they're the ones doing it, but it's us setting up the protocols. Like right now, one of the things we're really working on, we have a focus on the mom and puppies and making sure they're getting extra attention, because it's something we notice is lacking a lot in the shelter. So because there's so many things, we try and pinpoint which are the animals most at risk and most sensitive, and right now, in terms of the dogs, it's those moms and puppies. So that's kind of what we've been working on the last few weeks, so trying to really instill in their mind that they need food at all times, they need clean kennels. Can we move them to sections of the shelter that don't have people touching them all of the time?
Is it okay with you, since we're not going to do this right here, go through each item, that is it okay with the committee if I meet with you and we go over what our progress is on each one of these items? And of course, like I said, there's always items. This was just thrown together.
Yeah.
Does the committee have an issue with that? Okay, so that's basically, I'll follow up with you.
I don't have an issue with it, but I would think that possibly at our next meeting, Jose could address these issues
to
the committee as opposed to you.
Oh, I agree. I just want to make sure that each one is going to go that way. So that right now, he knows what it is we're actually looking at. I can just hand him this and say, here it is. We can do that too. But there should be a report out. No, there'll be a report out.
Okay.
That's not a problem. I just wanted to be able to get a deep prior to that. Okay. I'm sorry, Ms. Entas?
Thank you, Mr. Carmen.
With regard, two points
or questions on the subject of the wetlands.
Jane, can you speak up?
Well, I can hear you. I have 2 points on the subject of bat holds. One, referring back to, your pages aren't numbered, but anyway. It was in the November minutes. And I argued with a lot of conviction, I think, that animals don't have to be held any longer for felony cases than they do for misdemeanor cases. And I, just to review very briefly, I pointed out that the Animal Control Center, by holding dogs longer for felony cases, is just not intentionally, of course, but making these animals suffer for the second time. And the felony cases are the animals that have been abused, supposedly worse than the other animals, and then they have to be abused again by being held longer at the animal control just because they're felony cases, and there is no law that requires that at all. And and I pointed out that the Animal Control Center has a very fine record of winning its cases. They don't need to do anything special in felony cases. They have a very fine record of winning just about all their cases. In the misdemeanor cases, just by testifying, you don't have to have a live animal. They just win the cases by their credible testimony and by showing photographs. And then another point is, the dog is dead. I don't think they have to drag the dead dog's body into the court. So why hold a felony case animal longer? And then on the minutes, it says here, staff will visit with attorney regarding Ms. Shireen's concerns. So I want to know if you have Mr. James. Have you asked an attorney about this point?
Ms. Shireen, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, absolutely have initiated the dialogue, and I'm trying to sit down and talk with them and hope that they'll be very, very soon on that. Yes, ma'am.
Very soon?
Yes, ma'am. To talk the whole issue. Yes, ma'am.
Then I have my other point on the same question here is, let's see, number 6. It's on the list of holds. That first one for the where we reached the bottom place, and it said the dock will be held further until the order to show cause hearing is set up. So I was wondering, did you have the order to show cause hearing? Mr. James, I'm what happened.
Ms. Raina, Mr. Chair, members of the committee, that order to show cause hearing is on the 2nd of January. Of 2015.
I'm trying to attend that. Where's it going to be? Did you say January 2nd?
Yes, ma'am. January 2nd, 2015. We'll get you the court that it's going to be in.
It'll be
in county court. And we'll,
county court?
Yes, ma'am. And we'll get you the location as soon as we know.
Okay, I appreciate that. Thank you.
Is there anything else, Ms.
Not on that phone.
Very good. Okay. Yes, sir.
What are the alternatives to the not held in animal care? What are the alternatives for that, for the dog?
Mr. James?
Mr. Jacobs, Mr. Chair, there's many options that are available. Fostering is an option that the animals in a position where we can make it available as an animal available to be released, and we can take that course of action. So pretty much all the options that a non-case related pet would be available for that in that situation.
Mr. Jacobs?
So is it the policy not to use those tools for a felony case, or is it that there's some reason why these individual dogs aren't in place? Generally speaking, I'm not asking for a particular case, I'm just trying to get the general idea. You said that all these dogs could be handled in the same fashion as any other dog, but they're not. And I guess I'm trying to understand what would cause them not to be treated as any other dog.
Mr. Jacobs,
Mr. Chair, members of the committee, historically, law enforcement, and even I had a meeting with a set of attorneys, it was several years ago, about the need for solid evidence to include evidence related to the rehabilitation of the animal, what it would take, and to indicate how severe and how bad the owner was. And as a result of that, animals were being maintained and rehabilitated at the animal care center over time to demonstrate how simple, in some cases, the steps the owner would have had to take to keep them from being in that situation. So just as that evidence, set of evidences that we were successful with in court, demonstrate why this owner should be held accountable and how severely the owner should be held accountable. However, Ms. Shireen, it is correct that there's no law that requires that we hang on to them. And we're going to visit with the attorney so that the whole process is maintained as validity, and we have sufficient for what we need to have without holding on to them. They are naturally necessary.
Thank you.
On that same issue, though, as you're meeting with these individuals that are representing the agency on this, would you be able to note to them that dogs that are going to fosters can be weighed every day, every week, just as well as being weighed at the center? It would actually save us money at the center, and it would be better for the dog. So there is that criteria that would allow for presentation of the case with having the documentation that they need, whether it's weight or pictures or whatever. Wherever that dog is, or cat, wherever that animal is, there is the criteria that they would need probably could be even better gotten by those individuals that are taking care of that animal right then and there rather than being at, unless it's something that's so dire that has to have a doctor or a veterinarian taking care of it all the time.
Mr. Chair, members of the committee, those are exactly the kind of discussions we're going to have to, so that we are able to use foster where possible, as often as possible, and ensure whatever chain of evidence issues arise out of that, and still meet the needs of the court plus the needs of the
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. With that, we are going to move into the rescue program, which is on the agenda. I indicated that I was going to give out instructions as to how we're going to run this particular portion of the meeting. The way we're going to set it up is that the rescue, or the individuals that are representing the rescue, will have a total of 20 minutes to begin with, and at the podium state their position, their case, their whatever it is that they want to do. After that point, the pendulum will swing to whether management or the PAC management would like to respond and or have anything that they would like to have input or present to the committee. Then it moves back for rebuttal, if there is any, to the individuals from the rescue committee. And then it would go back to redirect rebuttal on the part of the PAC management. At that point, during those particular issues that are being brought up or discussed, the committee members, you will have the ability to ask questions. You don't have to keep it to the very end, because I know if I do that, I'll forget anything past a couple minutes. So what we'll do is raise your hand, and what I'll do is, at the risk of being interrupting, we'll still have to do that because it's best to get the question out there and get it answered. And so I'll just make some noise with the gavel so that whoever's up there talking will know that there is a question and that they don't have to stop what they're doing at that moment. It's just a matter that there'll be a question out here just for a moment, and then they can answer that question and then continue on. So that's the system we use. That's the system that I'm comfortable with. So with that, we'll get started. Is there, from the rescue groups, is there going to be one individual speaking or more than one? I'm speaking kind of into the air right now, so I don't know who's the speaker for the rescue groups.
We were unaware that the meeting was going to be set up in this manner, so we kind of have first call, last call, opposed to a speaker that is going to speak on behalf of rescues and volunteers.
I did make it known, though, to a number of rescue groups.
I'm with the Arms of Angels, and I did not know.
You did not know, but there's no way
I will probably fly, stand up, and bring some concerns. I don't think it'll be as in-depth as it would have been had I had noticed, but I'll start.
No, we have, just keep it, Mr. Jacobs, just a second. We have 20 minutes, so don't take up all the time that your rescue groups will have. Mr. Jacobs, what did you want to say?
I rise to the point of order. I believe what you described as a hearing, a public hearing that needs special and, notice on the agenda, not just simply the word rescue program.
Well, we're not going
to... No, may I finish my point of order?
Certainly, my apologies.
If we are going to have a public hearing, we have to give notice on the agenda and meet all the open meeting requirements. And I don't believe we have done so, or simply put it in what we have on the agenda tonight. I would support a public hearing at the call of the chair as long as it's on the agenda.
Mr. James?
Chair, if I might, as I recall the discussion the last meeting, that the item was on the committee's agenda, and it was tabled based upon the staff saying they were going to present a policy and a procedure along with a code of protocol, for lack of a better term, code of conduct document to the committee. And the committee said, let's table it until we have that so we can make our discussion based upon, so that you can have your discussion based upon your direction here. I believe Mr. Jacob's comment is a little, probably more appropriate way to take this is that the committee my boss is behind me in my next raise, but I'm going to say this anyway. The committee received the report and the draft policy that the staff had handed to us in the attachment, and then placed this on as a public hearing for next meeting, with the committee members having a chance to review the staff input, and the public having a chance to review the staff's input, and then have this discussion that you just described at the next meeting under the heading of a public hearing, clearly and outline on the agenda.
Yes, in touch.
I would like to make a motion for a special meeting of this committee just specifically for this issue, so that Rescue can address this. We will have a chance to review the material, and only this topic will be on the agenda.
I'm not trying to conduct this as a hearing by any stretch, because a hearing in and of itself then will require a decision. And because there will be no decision by the committee at this point, the only thing we're listening to is two parties expressing themselves. It's on the agenda as far as it was based on Rescue, and you put it on the agenda. So both parties last time did not have an opportunity to discuss it or even give their opinions like we normally have. Individuals get up and talk on Rescue. It somewhat moved over to pregnant animals. So that is the reason why I was on this time, so that both sides could talk about what it is they want to talk about as far as Rescue. Like I said, hearings mean that I would be, or we would be, rendering a decision on something, and we're not. We're just listening to what they're saying. So I would like to know from the committee, do you want to pursue down that path, or do you want to then postpone this again to do what we would call a hearing? But I don't think that is what we are even supposed to be doing, is having a hearing.
My question, Mr. Jacobs, is that what the chairman just said, Chairman Newman, It wouldn't be a hearing. Could we not just follow what's on the agenda now? I certainly don't feel the need to have a special meeting.
My proposal wasn't for a special meeting.
No.
A hearing doesn't require that the committee take any action. If we are going to take action, we have to put that on the agenda, that we also, hold a hearing and take action. If we simply are going to take a hearing, fine. If people want to come up and speak, I have no problem with that in accordance with the agenda as published. They could have come up in the beginning, they could come up at the end. But that's under the open meetings, we listen to it, we can't discuss it, we can't ask questions. You're going further than that. You're saying that we could ask questions. And assuming we could ask questions of the presenters, which is not part of the agenda and the open meeting as presented. If we wanted to ask those questions, then we have a hearing, we ask questions, we take testimony, at the end of which we can say thank you, and that's the end of it.
I guess I have a difference of opinion from you. When it says Rescue Program, or whatever program it is, or whatever we're talking about, individuals can get up and talk, and we can talk to them. I mean, I don't know what they're going to say. So on the agenda, we could not put down everything on the agenda. What we did have was some of the things that they were going to say, and that was given to Mr. James, and it was sent out as part of the package, which is some of the letters that you see. So what we put out was everything we had on the issue of Rescue Program. Now, if there was more, if I knew more about what people are going to talk about, if I had some sort of, things to do on the Tonight Show, if he knows what they're going to say, the Grand Carniac or whatever, then I'd be able to put that out. But I do not know what people are going to say prior to that, so therefore, we can only reasonably put out what we know. And since that this is just the Rescue Program here is all we know, the Rescue Program wants to make some points. Management from PAC doesn't have to make any type of points. They don't have to talk at all. It doesn't matter. They just have their, it's on the agenda for a Rescue Program. So we asked them last time, saying that we need more information based upon you putting it on the agenda. We need more information. You want to tell us more? Come right ahead and tell us. That's the reason I'm confused about a hearing and having more. four agenda items to go out there, because even if we now, right now, said, okay, let's postpone it until next month and put more out for a public meeting, I don't even have anything more to put out. So how are we out of order is what I don't understand.
Well, my recollection is somewhat like Mr. James. We asked the staff to provide information. They have done so. That information now is, you know, the information I think it is, it's just that I received it tonight, right?
And that is going to be made public, right?
I think it should be made public with proper notice so people can read it and comment on it before not give us documents and then say, now come up and talk about it. And secondly, it says clearly that we cannot comment on what people say when they come up, you know, to call in the audience. We have to listen to them. Unless it's a personal matter that they, you know, that they ranted and raved regarding, you know, I wear a hat and they don't think I should, then I can comment on that. But beyond that, we can't comment.
That's not what I heard the attorney say. And I'm not going to go back and forth. So with that, we're going to hear from, if it's wrong, then I guess someone needs to explain it better to us, because we did have the attorney, and from what I heard, that particular attorney with specific knowledge of how things were supposed to run indicated that you put out as much as you can. I agree with you that it's best to have that information prior to it, but they were not providing it at the time. They didn't send it in to me saying, this is what we're going to be presenting. That would have been good to have, and then we could have put it out. But it isn't. So at this point, we can do two things. We can hold this, and they can talk, but they can't present the information until now, till the next time. But they can talk about the information. The same thing would hold true with the rescue groups. But as far as what they have to say, this committee does not know what they're going to say, and therefore we can't publicize what they're going to say before they say it. So with that, whoever's talking for the rescue groups, would you please step on up and make your presentation or say what you want to say about the rescue program? You indicated that you wanted to speak, but I know I talked with, I thought Terry Goddard or Kim Silver or somebody was going to be speaking, so you guys need to kind of get it together and know. We used up for 20 minutes, so now you have like a minute. You have 20 minutes.
There's three of us, I believe, that are going to speak.
Okay, so you each have like 7 minutes.
That's easy.
Unless you want to pass it off to each other. Yeah, we have to fill out that form.
Let me fill that.
No, I did not fill out.
But we'll get you to do it afterwards.
My name is Kim Brandon. I'm here as a concerned member of the public, and I foster for In the Arms of an Angel organization and have been doing so for about 3 years. All those years I've had several direct interactions with that. Due to the time constraints, I'm going to select the topics that I find the most time sensitive and important to share my input on today. In previous years, there was a lot more cooperation from PAC with regards to rescue group communication. That cooperation has suffered dramatically in the last 1 to 2 years. The rescue groups offer a free volunteer service for taking animals that are not adoption ready and relieving the burden from PAC of having to care for or euthanize these animals. This is a huge resource that's not being utilized to its fullest potential, and in fact, it seems to meet with opposition in daily operations. This is essentially an impact to the budget and ultimately to tax dollars. While the foster program being run through PAC is fine, it's a program filled with animals that PAC is still responsible for maintaining the health and welfare of, not to mention the staffing resources to track all of those animals that are out there in foster homes, whereas independent rescue groups alleviate that, all of it. One instance that serves as an example of how mismanaging existing resources has a significant impact. When I walked through the kennel tent, one of the first things that I noticed was that the cement floor and the slab of the tent was not properly designed and poured for the use of being a dog kennel floor. There was no drainage trench built in the floor, as is seen in the main kennel buildings. For hosing and cleaning
no way to direct the waste material flow properly, which has resulted in unsanitary conditions that require more staff hours than would have been necessary if it was properly planned. As has been pointed out, the shelter is understaffed, and with the improper planning of this issue, it results in staff hours being spent moving dogs and mopping kennels and trying to contain dog waste from adjoining kennels that could have been alleviated with initial planning and appropriate use of the existing resources by having kennel floor constructed properly in the first place. Although I do not know the cost of having the floor saw cut in order to have this problem fixed, if it has not been looked into, it might be worthwhile to save the man hours that are currently taken up right now by maintaining the conditions that were a result of that slab. The last item I'd like to address at this time is the spay and neuter issue. Many valid points have already been raised by the rescue group, so in addition to that, I would also like to add, while I agree with a statement that was made at the last meeting that dogs are not humans and do not necessarily mourn the loss of litters of unborn puppies, I have personally seen the imbalanced behaviors that have resulted in late-term spay mother animals. In many instances, for the rest of their lives, they try to nurse stuffed animals and rolled up socks or any other variety of items, and then cry incessantly when doing so. Therefore, there often is a residual effect on the mother animal in later-term abortion spay. And to state that the unborn babies are being aborted to somehow improve the welfare of the mother animal is a broad stretch. Unless, of course, the mother animal is in medical distress, and that is another topic altogether. In my opinion, to not institute a procedure to try and work with rescue groups to accommodate the humane handling of these pregnant animals that go through the PAC system is a direct conflict with the mission statement of the humane treatment that PAC is trying to achieve, not to mention the image that they are trying to sell the public through, through the media. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
My name is Terry Goddard, and I'm with Tucson Ovetnosis. Back in April of last year, we had a meeting, and we talked about early networking, and we talked about pregnant moms and babies. And in October, since there were no results at all from that meeting, I put out a request of 5 points, and it's actually gotten to 6 points, about how rescue organizations and volunteers could help. Some of these have actually been done, and I really do appreciate that. I have seen some improvement by the rescue coordinator, and that is the once a week list of seniors. We are now getting that, and that's very appreciated. We are also getting the once a week list of small dogs. And I've noticed an increase of these dogs getting out. I'm still trying to get them to not put on the long daily rescue list, animals that are in distress or will be coming up for short term. Still waiting on that. And the reason I want it on a separate list is it really brings it to the forefront. Right now we have 10 dogs on a short list that need to be out by October, by December 22nd, or they will all be euthanized. And some were brought up on the long daily list, and the volunteers catch them and they put them on Facebook. But I have yet to see the PAC staff do that. I'd like to see that change immediately. Also, I would like immediate notification of pregnant, possible pregnant, or moms with babies entering Pima County, Pima Animal Care Center. What's happening is they come in and then they sit there. And then, only through the volunteers and the rescue, some of the rescue staff walking the kennels that find these animals just sitting there, and they bring it to our attention so that we can network them. So we're not getting enough communication from PAC staff about those animals as well. Also, purebreds. One time, I was standing by the door in intake, and an English setter came in, gorgeous, but huge, and I thought, that dog is going to take up so much room in a kennel. I happened to know someone through National Brittany Rescue. I took a shot, and I called her up, and I said, there's a gorgeous dog here. I took a picture of it. I sent it to her. Within 24 hours, that dog was out of PAC. One less dog taking up unnecessary space. So I've asked the rescue coordinator and the supervisor of the rescue coordinator to please put out a list of purebreds that come in so that I, just me, little old me that works all the time and does other things, will put out that information to all the purebred rescues. Some of them take mixes, you'd be surprised. So it's just another way to empty out the kennels faster and so dogs don't get ill or hang in there without being noticed. And last but not least, I would like 72-hour notice before aborting pregnant dogs so that we do have an option to take them out and give them, put them in special foster homes that are, have strong strengths on taking care of moms and babies. And there are a lot of responsible rescues out there that do take this on. And I think that's it. If I could get those short lists instead of on a long daily list, I think it would improve getting the animals out much quicker, including cats. I hate to say, I didn't mention the cats. I also am willing to network the cats as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Hi, Tiffany again from In the Arms of Angels. So quickly, I wanted to address a few concerns that were brought up right now in the audience. Volunteers are the ones doing rounds and assessing medical to animals and bringing it to the medical staff's attention. It would be nice if staff did rounds, opposed to putting that burden solely on the volunteers. There is continual pressure on volunteers to do more. Well, there's not enough staff to do adoptions today, so we're going to close the tent unless you guys do it. It's kind of threatening. I want to address the moms and puppies having specific care from inmates. Currently, there are two families at Pima Animal Control. Currently, the last 3 days when I've gone there, they've not had fresh water, they've had no food, they've had no bowl, so it's not like they just finished their food. So the inmates teaching inmates how to take care of them is not working. Those moms and pups that are at Pima Animal Control are not being networked by the staff. In fact, I've got tired of asking for that to happen over the last 13 months and last couple weeks just started doing it myself. A lot of the information of when the moms come in, pictures of them, how many there are, I actually get off a volunteer-ran Facebook page called Pack Pets Needs You. Again, not from the staff. Last week I sent out an email, there were seven families there. One family, the mother got very sick, I heard distemper. I don't know if that was confirmed and the puppies were euthanized. The other four families have been pulled and put into rescue, leaving two. And that was with me and volunteers networking them. I obviously do not have the resources that staff do. I'm trying to build an email contact list to network these. But it would be nice, you know, when they, if the mothers and puppies were addressed by staff and promoted by staff. Today, while I was at Pima Animal Control, two separate litters of puppies, there was a bottle feeder litter and a litter that were 4 weeks old. The only reason why I know about them is because I was there when they came in. And fortunately for me, Patsy that runs the foster care program for PAC, we were able to work together. We're gonna get together after this meeting through text and see where they can be placed at. But that's because I was there. Not because I got an email, not because anyone from Intake notified us. So it's very difficult as a rescue and for volunteers that are also, they may not be involved in organized rescue, but they are rescued because they're networking those animals. They don't have the support of staff. There's a definite divide between staff and volunteers and rescue volunteers. I feel that there was a division of the three units. Volunteer and rescue have come together a long way in the last 2 months because we've had to fill in the gaps for the information that we don't receive from staff. If we're networking these animals and trying to get them out and spending our time doing it, it would be nice to have information that comes from intake where all the animals are processed. Hey, we just got in some bottle feeders. Let's start contacting these rescues. Let's network them. Michelle had, the rescue coordinator, had sent out an email. This is just an example. She had sent out an email in September on 9:20, she sent out an email of moms and pups and pregnant animals saying they need to get out now. Moms and pups, or pregnant dogs, will be spay boarded if they're not pulled. So on that email, a litter of 5 puppies went to rescue. A litter of 3 chihuahuas went to Miss Maggie May's rescue. Sunshine, a pregnant dog, went to Bark Animal Rescue. She had her puppies and was spayed at PAC yesterday. Applesauce was on 10/13, her medical notes indicated she had 3 puppies. Not sure why she was not spay boarded by the deadline of 9/24, but she was not. Her puppies passed away and there was no more medical indicating if she was still there or not. But these lists, I mean, that list that she sent out moved dogs. It moved the groups because she had all the right people to network to. I think that's, you know, the best I can do on the fly. Anyone else?
Thank you. Okay, based upon what we were discussing prior to that, anybody else want to make any comments? Particularly if the PAC wants to make any comments on that, we are going to hold your submissions until they're going to be put out till next time, and then we get more of a ruling on any submissions that were sent or given to us today, how we're going to handle that.
Mr. Chair, I think you're fine in going the course you set from the very beginning. You made a stretch and you made a decision that's what the authority is.
Okay.
Sorry. Mr. Chair, members of the committee, you set the course originally. I see no reason not to stay.
With that, then we'll continue down that path. Ms. Santage, you had a comment?
I have a question regarding chameleon and the intake, because all animals are put into chameleon as animals are coming in, right? Is there a function that can be enabled that an animal goes in and there's a code that says possible pregnancy or whatever, and there are a series of rescue groups that are in this and a mass email or text goes out? The reason I'm saying this is, for instance, today I got a text from an animal clinic because an animal was scheduled to be seen sponsored by Animal Rescue League. And this came in. I got notification this animal was coming in to make me aware of the situation. I was not the counselor on duty. However, it went out to 3 counselors because they had my text information in their computer. It was from a clinic I wasn't even aware that we were affiliated with, which is my fault. But I'm just wondering if there is something that can be incorporated into Chameleon, that it's not necessarily breed specific or whatever, but anybody who is wishing to have that type of a notification, it can be coded into Chameleon and the computer shoots out a text. There's a possible animal at PAC that needs to be addressed as it's coming in the door. And so they're getting real-time information.
Ms. Emptage, Mr. Chair, members of the committee, certainly something that the staff will look at if they've heard the same thing you've heard. They have action items on these items. They have recognized that there's much more to do. And they'll take a look at the capacity and the capabilities of all the resources when we move to the community. So not get specifically on whether or not you can shoot out text or emails or those kind of things. It has some of those types of capacities, and that's part of what we added into the equation as they go through this and fix this.
So one of the things to address that and to continue that conversation a little bit is I've spoken with some of the leadership at the health department, and they had indicated that the possibility of looking into whether the rescue or whoever would be had a certain amount of access to the chameleon to actually look themselves. Now, I don't know if that's going to be true, and we've talked about a little about that, and if that's even a possibility, but you know, with a certain amount of firewall to allow outside people to take a look at what's in there, almost on a real-time inventory basis like that. And so we haven't actually seen that yet, but I know I spoke with Dr. Garcia about that once, and we talked about that type of thing. Is that possible? I don't know
what the recourse has been yet on that, because I know Chameleon can do a lot of things, but I don't know if it can do that either, so maybe we can find that out at the next meeting. And get like a chameleon. I believe the Chameleon Guru actually lives in Tucson. So maybe we can pay that person to show us. Anyway, with that, I'll move to the management at PAC to make a presentation or to say really whatever you want to say.
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, thank you for your time, and thank you as always for continuing to work and labor on behalf of the well-being of animals and humans in this community. I wanted to make sure that a couple of points were crystal clear. I also wanted to try to figure out how to be most constructive in this effort today. You have brought up some questions, we have some answers, we have some responses, but really, oh God, that's poorly. But really what we want to do is I want to talk about what the big picture is. The big picture is that without the help of rescue partners in this community, 1,507 animals would have been destroyed last year. Make no bones about it, that would have been the outcome of those 1,507 animals. And we do not, as PAC, take that lightly. Both in the area of adoptions, in the area of special needs adoptions, and God knows in the area of the rescue effort, volunteer organizations are vital, are essential, are part of the solution. They don't, however, represent the entire solution. One of the things that we can show you is that in the last 4 years, we've been able to increase tremendously the number of animals that have live outcomes out of our facility with essentially very negligible increases in staff. That's the reality. That's not going to be sugar-coated. And with very modest increases in operations. So that's the reality that we're working from. So our goal as the health department and as the PAC leadership team is to try to figure out how to make each of those dollars stretch just as much as possible, without killing our people, without driving our volunteers crazy, and without making rescue organizations run the other way away from us. So that's the context that we're working from. What I'd like to do with you today is I'd like to share with you where we're moving in terms of our rescue effort, to sort of give you a big picture of that, and to let you know what we've done up until now, and give you a little bit of an idea of where we would like to go. When I spoke with you, Mr. Chairman, about my aspirational dream of being able to, on a real-time basis, be able to see every single animal in our facility, that is very much an aspirational dream of mine, and something that we are far from being able to accomplish today. I think in the long run it would help us place more animals effectively into loving long-term homes, and it would also make things a little bit more clear for the partners who are looking for this information. At this point, we have so many animals in our facility on any given day that it becomes a real challenge to get the right kinds of lists to the right kinds of people using the right kinds of timing. Although I'll tell you that has actually been one of our areas of relative success, and that I think is really important to share. as we move forward, I'm not sure that it's terribly productive for us to sort of go back and forth, but I think what would be helpful for us is to sort of lay out where we're at, to take the feedback that you've given, and then to use our best professional judgment to continue to move the organization forward. As Mr. James indicated, when we have, and we've been meeting very closely with all the jurisdictions that account for about 60% of the intakes in our facility, they do not all share the common values that we have with regards to the importance of this work. And so that is the other political reality that I have to deal with, that we all have to sort of be cognizant of. So I'm going to turn it over to my team, who's going to talk a little bit more about this. I apologize for the horrible projection.
Mr. Chair, members of the committee, thank you for giving us an opportunity to speak. Sorry. There's a lot of things that were said this evening, and certainly we could provide answers to a lot of them, and perhaps some of the team will want to. There's one thing that I want to say the most, which I was going to talk about when we got to the partnership agreement, but I'll say it now because I think it applies. A lot of things were said tonight that I completely agree with. I think it was Ms. Pope that said that the system is broken. And we have had a lot of conversations, especially the last month, but since I started, about how the system is broken, how the relationships are with the volunteers, how the relationships are with our rescue community. And we've seen it get worse, and we feel it too. We're not going to stand here tonight and say to you we disagree with any of that. The question is, and what we honestly don't have the answer to, is where do we go from here, and how do we fix that? It's really hard because there's a lot of feelings involved, and I know that I got off on the wrong foot with a lot of people in this room, and it's hard to take those feelings and then put those aside and say, okay, how do we move forward as a group? And that's really what our partnership agreement was, really what that's about and what we wanted to accomplish with that. It's our way of saying, you know, yeah, we agree, we are on board, we want to make this better with you, we want to have a healthy relationship and a productive relationship with you, because we want the same things. We might have a difference of opinion of how we get there and some of the policies and procedures, but we truly want the same things. And so how do we say, okay, let's sort of press reset and let's structure this in a way that we can have constructive dialogue and we can work together as partners. Those are the things that we want. And so, I mean, I think we sort of humbly say today, how do we get there? How do we work together to get there? And so I don't know if the team wants to add anything else to what I had to say.
Yeah, I just, over the past year, 6 months, for years I've worked closely with a lot of the rescue community and volunteers, and Kristen's absolutely right. The system right now that we have is broken. The relationship is broken. There's concerns that I think all of us have is whether or not it's going to be able to be fixed. I think in order to fix it, Kristen's right, we need to just let the past be the past, sit down and have these conversations and work together, because ultimately it's the pets that are being impacted. We can't do it without volunteers. The daily shelter in every aspect won't run without volunteers. We're not gonna solve this. We're not going to achieve our goal of saving the savable and pushing that envelope to save more each year without the rescue organizations. And we're not gonna do any of that without the shelter staff. We all need to work together. Over the past few months, I noticed and I hate to even say it in sides, but it's become this true division of, Tiffany was right, it has become volunteers and rescue versus the staff. And in simple correspondence, it's digging in the heels. I said it in a meeting with No Guilt Pima County and the last advisory committee that I've been guilty of not jumping as quickly as I should have on something because of my own just defensiveness. But it goes both ways. I see it in the emails, the threads, the Facebook posts, everything else.
and it's not healthy. It's not solving anything for the pet. So I really think we all need a fresh start, and we all need to start communicating better and not being as offensive. And I don't know if it's there, but I would love to hear from our rescue community volunteers.
So, you know, even though we brought our policy piece, if it is acceptable to you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, members of the committee, we'll leave it for your study and feedback. I will end with one by making a statement. If you look at where we were 4 years ago today, the combined efforts of the special needs adoptions, total adoptions, and the rescue organizations, just this last, in the last 12 months, we've exceeded that. We've exceeded that tremendously. We are way better off as a community in terms of where we are on this issue than we ever have been. And that is all essentially with a relatively flat budget, not entirely flat, because we did have a blip up of approximately 6 FTE, if I remember the tent. But with a relatively flat budget, with a relatively flat staff. So we can talk about all the things that we are doing wrong. I think we also need to celebrate what we are all doing right: volunteers, rescue, and PAC staff. And I'm personally very invested in continuing to make progress in this area. And I'm very invested in allowing our staff to continue to bring their professionalism to bear and their judgment to bear on the problems that we have. We certainly don't know everything, but there's an incredible wealth of experience among the folks that we have. And I think that speaks for itself. So thank you, Mr. Chairman, for allowing me to, and for allowing our team to speak to you today. You have in front of you the proposed policy. You have in front of you the proposed agreement. And you have also, I believe, a brief summary of some of the other progress that we've made in the area of rescue.
Thank you, Doctor. I see there's, I'm going to need you guys to fill out these things, since we're kind of going down that path as to who's filling them out. Even including the staff, we'll just have you complete these documents showing you as speakers. Tiffany, I believe, is that your hand up?
You want me to go back up there? Or am I
no, you can speak.
Okay. So they asked what they can do to get back on the right path. An apology. An apology speaks wonders. From my experience, Justin is the only one who ever apologizes and says, "I overstepped my bounds," or "this was inaccurate." An apology. We've had meetings with Jose where he doodled through the entire meeting. We brought concerns to him and he skipped out and says, "That's how I do." I had Miss Barney give me a call one time to ask why In the Arms of Angels considerably reduced the number of animals pulled this year. There was never a follow-up. We take our time and go to these meetings. And then when PAC staff is asked for, "Let's follow up, let's get back on track," there's nothing. It fizzles. An apology is a step in the right direction. I don't know anything about the policy change that they submitted, the packet. I don't know how it affects my rescue. I can say that as a rescue and as an animal lover in the community who works for PAC, we stopped pulling this year. AOA stopped pulling considerably because of a huge incident in December where there was a dog that was not properly taken care of. And when staff was questioned on it, they said, "You know what, the dog didn't die, it was fine, what's the big deal?" I stopped pulling. I started taking from other shelters, I started taking from the community because I could not handle that. There's a lot of I'm going to tell you I'm going to do this, and then they go over here and do that. When In the Arms of Angels came back full force, pulling from HAC, was when we had those meetings with Pima Animal Control and No Kill Pima County. During those meetings, Dr. Wilcox verbally agreed with me to network those pregnant animals. Justin agreed to network those pregnant animals, and I forget who else was in that meeting. I believe Jose was there. There was, that's what it was. And in agreeance, AOA said, we will make HAC our primary pool source again. They went back on their words. We're still continuing on ours. So again, apologies and not talking out of both sides of their faces will go a long way to fix our relationship. We're ready. We're fighting because we want to work with them. So we're definitely open to it, but it needs to be on an open playing field, not behind closed doors when our backs are turned.
Thank you. Yes.
I just have one small thing to say. I'm Robin Novlin of Southern Arizona People Rescue. We've always made PAC our priority, although we don't hold as many dogs as some of the other rescues. But I think one thing that would go a long way for me is when I've gone there to pull dogs, you know, and I've notified Rachel and or Michelle, and I just get treated horribly when I go. Sorry, but I do. I get treated like, well, Michelle's not here. You have to come back. This is like, really? You know, I'm trying to eliminate dogs from your shelter. And honestly, I have been treated like that. And I don't know if it's lack of training, lack of cross-training. The coordinator's not there. Nobody can help the rescue. I remember one time Rachel called in sick, and it was the second time we agreed to take a dog, and I was told, well, she's not here, nobody can help you. Finally, Michelle, who was not who she is now, paged Justin, who came and helped me, because it's like, I'm sorry, I'm not leaving without the dog. So that's all, I would just like, you know, to be treated respectfully, that's all. Thank you.
I actually want to talk to what she just said. When I came to pick up my first rescue dog, she was pregnant. There was a big urgent all over her page on, it was probably 5+EG that I saw her the first time. You know, pregnant dog, has pneumonia, needs out of PAC ASAP. And I came as a member of the community to go get her. I have experience breeding dogs. I was qualified to be able to help her and take her out of that situation. I was turned away with a list. I was told you can't adopt a pregnant dog. You can spay abort her and then take her home. But you can't adopt her. She was 8 weeks pregnant. You cannot adopt her straight out. And I said, well, I can pay to spay and neuter the puppies. And they said, I'm sorry, you can't do that. You have to go through rescue. Here's a list. They gave me a list. It was a page this long. Told me two numbers of people who would be most likely to be able to help me. I contacted all those people. I sent an email for an application into AOA, and then I went back that afternoon because they had sent me away, and I was going to not leave without the dog, and she said, although Tiffany happened to be there. And so we were able to coordinate, and I did leave with the dog. But as a member of the community, if they were trying to rescue a dog and they hit that many roadblocks, not everybody is as tough as I am or as willing to go the length that I was willing to go, because I would have called the news reporters that day if they hadn't let me go home with that dog. So they just kind of lucked out as far as that situation goes, because I happened to be there when Tiffany happened to be there and we were able to coordinate together. The way that we are treated when we come to pull a dog sometimes is excellent. Sometimes it's excellent. You come in, they see that you're there, they take care of you, your paperwork's done, and you're able to go out the door. Other times we wait, and we wait, and we wait, and we wait, and we wait. While other people take dogs, come in after we come in, and leave with animals before we leave, because we're just rescue, and they're members of the community doing special needs adoptions, and they take priority over rescue, which, for the most part, I understand. But it does get frustrating, and I've spent 4 hours at PAC to pick up one dog. So that is definitely an issue. Thank you.
follow up on what she's done.
Okay, we're gonna have three more people talk, and then we're gonna cut the subject block.
I've had to wait over 3 hours also, and the dogs were ready, but as like she's saying, with the SNAs, they get priority. We sit and wait. On this one particular lot from last time, I was meeting a group out of Prescott. We were supposed to meet at 2:30. I didn't meet them until 4 o'clock. So it was really, you know, a hassle. And they only have one person there being able to help with the rescue groups and with the adoptions. It was just really annoying.
Yes. I need those sheets. In the very back, you have your hand up.
My name's Tara. I've been volunteering at PAC for probably about 9 months now. So I'm pretty new. I'm still figuring it all out. Wasn't super aware of the divide between staff and volunteers. When I started out, I definitely see it now. I feel like this might be a perfect example of what just happened. Justin was in the middle of kind of being warm, and then it was like cut off, and then it's like, but big picture, look at our numbers, look what we're doing. And it's like, we're rescue people, like we're trying to save animals, like we don't care about the big picture. And I think that's where like the conflict comes from, is it's like,
where we care about the big picture.
Well, I mean, but like for the shelter to look a certain way, like we know what the shelter looks like. You know, we see it, we see the reality of it, we see the things that like, it's not okay to say that this is an animal that's going to be killed. It's not okay to say it's going to be euthanized, or like, we have to like pick apart certain terminology about how we like represent animals on the internet when we're networking them, which takes away from like the urgency of what we're trying to accomplish, you know? It takes the fire out of what we're trying to like give to people and be like, look at what's happening in your community. Like, these are the homeless animals of your county, and they're going to die. There are 9 of them right now. 10 of them?
10.
And I mean, it's just like, I don't think that it's like a finger pointing game. Like, I'm not interested in blaming anyone, but it's like, that's what I'm looking for. What Justin was attempting to do, which is like show warmth, connect, understand. I know that you guys have a job to do, but it's like, that's where I feel like the divide comes from. I don't need an apology. I go there because that's what makes me feel good. It's important to me. But I just think that if we're all on the same team, like, and we all have to understand where everyone's coming from, like, then talk to me that way, you know? Like, and it's just so hard. Like, there's like a group, and like, it was really hard to kind of like get into that group and get to talk to someone without having to have someone that they used to work with standing next to me, giving the stamp of approval that I might actually know what I'm talking about. You know, it's just like, I'm here to help. Like, it's just like, you gotta hear me out. And it's like, I feel like there's so many, like, I've had so many meetings. I've jumped, you know, through so many hoops. And like, that's the problem, is like, the diplomacy of it all. It's just like, there's just constantly this like, you know, we have to be nice, we have to smile to your face. But it's like, no, like, this isn't smiley time. Like, you know, like, shitty stuff is happening. Like, you know, sorry for my language, but like, that's the reality, and it's like, we all know it, and I just don't want to have to like have this relationship where we have to pretend or represent the shelter in a way that it's not real, you know? I feel like that's a big part of the divide.
Thank you. I believe there's one more person that wanted to speak. Kim Brandon.
Terry spoke. Terry's going to speak. Terry
spoke.
I'm going to speak for everyone because I think that I can do this, okay? The biggest thing in my life is about communication. The lack of communication is what the breakdown is. Okay? Now, I don't see the rescue coordinator here. I asked her to be here tonight. I asked her supervisor. I think it's important that as her job, that she is here to hear from her partners.
Yep.
You know, she's not. And yes, they wanted her, they hired her. We didn't have any say on who they hired. I didn't agree at the time, but she is getting better. She's doing a better job. She needs to know that. And not from her supervisors, but from her past partners. And if she just goes a little further, we're almost there. We really are communicating. And if you know, we've been waiting and waiting for that.
the chameleon thing forever. Put it on paper. I am here every single day to get the word out, to network these animals. All these volunteers, all these rescues, all we want to do is help. And all we want to do is network, put the voice out for the animals. We can't do that unless they go the extra mile as well. And that means the rescue coordinator, please have Michelle come. She is an intricate part of this team. And to just have her hidden away somewhere, it's not going to work. We need to work as a team. And communicate. Come on, people, let's make it a team.
Okay, thank you very much.
Mr. Chair, I have a question. Why isn't there a way for, since we know who the rescue people are, for them to fast track so that when they come in, they fill out whatever the paperwork is, they pick up the animal, and they leave in a reasonable amount of time. It's not like buying a car where they want to keep in the dealership. If you're so tired, you'll take any price or any deal.
I don't have the answers to that, and it's a good question to pose, and I'm sure PAC staff might have the answer. I'm not sure we're going to
get that. Well, I don't have the answers, and I'm just asking because I don't know.
Ms. Entash?
I have the same question. I mean, is there a card or something they can come in saying they're with a group and they bring it up, and if the forms are, if they know that there's an animal that's available, they can just reach down, hold the animals, and they can fill the forms out, so they've got most of the paperwork filled out, so when they go in, they've got their paperwork in hand, ready to go with their organization information, that they can just, you know, print off a copy, and then case, you know, the kennel card and the information's on it, instead they have an ID number assigned to the volunteer coming in from the rescue organization so that it ties it in and it's verified with ID, so it maybe, you know, speeds up the process.
We have, okay.
Thanks.
Do you mind?
Oh,
okay.
We really have made an effort to streamline that process for them. Typically there's one rescue coordinator and myself that are processing all the SNAs. So when there's a day that there's only one of us there, it can be a wait. But what we've tried to do is if we know ahead of time that a rescue group is coming for a particular pet, then we'll process that paperwork, we'll have everything ready. So all that they need to do is fill out their information, read and sign on the back of the form, and then it's just a matter of prioritizing and getting them pet. For the most part, I feel very confident that the wait times aren't in the 2 hours and 4 hours like we heard tonight in the past that they have been. And I know that the paperwork that was processed today, those people were in and out. So I think that's the goal in general.
Ms. Entash.
Okay. Now, you're saying that they fill out the forms with their information. If the agency they're with has the paperwork already on file with you, say they have an identification card that has been issued in conjunction between PAC and that agency, and they have an ID, would that speed it up if somebody comes in and said, here's my ID, here's my number, and all their information's on file, so they're not constantly filling out the paperwork? Would that
all they're doing is signing who the transport is, who are they actually physically releasing the pet to,
okay. And
signing that they're agreeing to all of the basic rescue rules. So we're talking about name, address, phone number, printing name, and signature.
Okay.
All of the other stuff, if we know that they're coming ahead, we try really hard to get all of the other paperwork entered into Chameleon, medical records, anything that is associated with that animal, printed out ahead of time. So that all it is a matter of having them fill out that one form, which can be filled out while we're getting the pet.
Thank you.
Any other members of the committee have any questions or comments? No. I do, of course. I mean, it's good to hear all the different perspectives, and it's good to know that the PAC staff and management is trying and attempting to do certain things. I just have a couple suggestions to keep this moving in a certain way. That having a forum like this and airing the differences are good. People saying what they want to say, it's good to say that.
whether you heard it before or you haven't heard it before, and whether you've heard what they've said before or not, it's still good to hear it again. But to move forward, just in my own humble opinion, and I don't know what the rest of the committee thinks, is that focus groups, to have those and say, let's try this again, let's step back and try it again, to have a representative from management, PAC management, a representative, or at least, or more, however we want to do it, from them, from the rescue groups, in any area, whether it's the rescue groups and or the volunteers, because as a volunteer representative, I have my own issues with PAC that I need to be conveying, and lucky enough, I get the chance sometimes to speak directly to them, but right now, we're talking about the rescue, and so I'm just throwing it out there that if there's someone on the committee that would like to be present during, if PAC management chooses to have more meetings with the rescue groups, we would have a couple of representatives from the rescue groups, a couple of representatives from PAC, and a representative or two from the committee that can be part of that and help facilitate the dialogue back and forth, like you were kind of trying to do now. What about this? What about that? Can you do this? Can you do that? A lot of that, I understand, is staffing. I'm going to even have that on the agenda next time. And I know the doctor might roll his eyes, but we're never going to let up on that. The staffing is a huge issue for PAC. It affects us as volunteers because we end up doing what they can't do. So it goes into the rescue arena as well. So I'm throwing that out there as far as, does anybody on the committee, and is the doctor willing to have that type of dialogue with the rescue groups and continue it? I realize we've done a certain amount of that, but it seems like we always have to step back and try it again.
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, I think we've had lots of conversations. We will continue to have lots of conversations. It's part of what we have to do as a public entity. So yes, we welcome the opportunity to have those conversations. I also want to say that for those conversations to be most constructive, from my perspective, we have to sort of also acknowledge that these are not all, that all our stories are not bad stories, that all our stories, that we in fact have had some considerable successes, and that we need to build on them. God knows we need to work on customer service. God knows we need to work on communication. We need to work on infrastructure. All those are very legitimate and appropriate complaints. But like I said, I think we also have to sort of recognize the progress that has been made in no small measure due to the blood, sweat, and tears of our team. And we need to continue to be able to engage with all the rescue partners and all the volunteers who are also putting a lot of sweat equity and a lot of hard work into that effort.
Thank you. So I take that kind of as a yes. Is there anyone that would like to volunteer? I'm looking at you, Doctor.
Well, I did it. And the reason that I'm looking at you so meaningfully and why I raised my hand is because I was actually thinking something very similar on my way over here. How are we going to get the volunteers and the staff to sit down and forgive and forget and move forward? And everything that has been said today just makes me feel even more strongly that A, it needs to happen, but B, I actually see a willingness and on both parties to work together. I do think it's going to have to take a lot of forgiving and forgetting, but it's also gonna have to involve a lot of keeping your commitments. But then also, one thing that I like the idea of a committee because I think when the vast majority of the work that goes on at Pima Animal Care Center is done by volunteers, I really feel like they should have a voice in policy and procedure. I think that's only fair. And so a committee with maybe an elected delegate amongst the volunteers with the staff, and I certainly would be willing to participate as trying to be a relatively neutral party, I think that's a good way to get policy and procedure accomplished that everyone can be okay with and that we're more likely to comply with. And but I think everyone's going to have to understand that they're not going to get everything that they want. So it's going to have to be a lot of compromise. And so if we all go into it with that kind of an attitude, forgive and forget, compromise, try to keep in mind the fact that we're making decisions for the whole of Pima County. That's a lot of people and a lot of animals. So we really have to set aside our personal feelings and do what's best for, unfortunately, it is a big picture. We have to keep in mind the big picture. But, you know, the spay abort issue is a really hard one because the big picture would say control the population. We have to control the population. That's like the whole reason we're here is because the pet population's out of control. You take a look at those babies in that uterus, you know, with fur on them, and you put that needle in that vessel and you kill them, and then you tell me that that's not a horrible thing to do. But you also have to look in the faces of those puppies and kittens and tell them that they're going to have to die today because there's too many of them. And so there's not an easy answer, and we're all going to have to be willing to compromise a little bit. But I am willing to do whatever I can to help this process, because I think we all are so passionate about rescuing animals. I think that's why we all get so angry with each other, is because we all care so much. And with that kind of passion and love for these guys, I think we can do it. And I'll do whatever I can.
Thank you. As representative for the volunteers, I'd like to be with you as that. And the reason I say that is because right now, I mean, we all, just like what you indicated, everybody's very passionate about it. And part of it is, when you get into this, we can't back out of it then. It's kind of like the volunteers get involved in it, and we're not going, no matter how mad we will get, we're not backing out of it. We're not going away. We know you're not going away. It's like a family. So as mad as I will get, I'm not leaving. So that's what we want in our group. There's no backing out as rescues. We're all part of this. You can say what you want to say. You might not get everything you want. And you might not be able to get everything you want to say from us, but no one's going anywhere. And so it's not like bad blood, no bashing as far as people, but hopefully getting things connected. So I'm willing to be on there with you. And Dr. Garcia, you can, if you would like to appoint a couple of individuals, that would be wonderful. The rescue groups appoint a couple of individuals, and so we pretty much have that rounded with me representing volunteers in general, the rescues having a couple of people representing them, and management representing themselves as well.
Jim, I'd like to say one thing.
Just one moment. Helen?
And if you need another question on the committee, I would be welcome.
Very good. Okay, that'd be great. So we'll go with the three of us.
For the rescues, I really like if it was Justin and Michelle, since we work closely with them on a monthly form group.
Okay, well, your request can be noted. It's going to be Dr. Garcia's decision, but yes, I mean, it's good to know what it is you'd like to have. With that, I'm going to conclude that portion of this portion of that topic and move now to the volunteer code of conduct, which was requested by PAC themselves to be on our agenda. And so that's what we're talking about now.
Mr. Chair, Member of the Committee, I believe, on the point of discussion that she had heard, that it's in part of the package. It is in the package they handed out to you today, so go down to turn that over before she has anything else to add. On the court on a draft.
Ms. Barney, do you have anything you would like to add? Basically, I'm not going to respond to anything on the code of conduct because you just gave it to me today. So I can't really read it now and start questions.
Right, and I said what I felt needed to be said to sort of just prepare everyone for what our intention was and what the thoughts were behind it.
Okay. Well, thank you.
Mr. Chair, Member, if I may, this information provided today, obviously any input, feedback the committee has, please share with us. And
we can't hear, excuse me, but none of us can hear.
Thank you, I'm sorry. Mr. Chair, members of the committee,
this packet will be put on the website, so I'll have that access to it. And if any members of our guests that would like to have a copy, we can provide that as well upon request to our offices, publish on the agenda. And if you have any input or feedback, please share with us and make sure it gets to the staff.
Okay, so we'll carry this forward to the next meeting. We'll have an opportunity to read it. Probably Mr. Jacobs, the community, will have an opportunity to see it because it'll be on the site.
Okay.
And so we'll talk further, I guess, about the voter conduct next time.
Chairman, does that include all these documents?
But there's three, right?
Not counting the statistics, but I have three, but I'm not sure that's the total.
Yeah.
That's one. Request for documents and protocol change, one to follow program policies and procedures, same purpose as the first one, and then I think the one you described.
Yes, Pat?
My question is on the code of conduct, down here it says criteria required for PAC to ignore it. Where is that? Okay, it is volunteer policy and code of conduct. The code of conduct is not just for the volunteers, right? It's for the rescue groups and the staff. Is that correct?
I don't know.
Ms. Hubbard, member of the committee, it is drafted. You need to take a look at it to see exactly how you interpret it and feedback to the committee. It is intended to be universal.
Okay. Well, that would help in reading it.
Yes. All three items on next agenda.
Yes, sir. And post the publicly as Mr. Jacob.
Sure.
All right.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
The next item, Ms. Rintaj is not prepared to discuss that item, so that's being held until the next meeting. That's the. Animal welfare and dangerous animals. Is there any discussion on that? Is it Jane?
Yes. I saw one empty metal bowl nearby and a plastic bucket with some dirty water and a shoe inside of it. He had no potable water or food available. So she gave him citations for no license, no rabies vaccination, neglect to tie out, neglect shelter, neglect water, and neglect food. This animal was allowed to be redeemed. Why was this animal accepted? Six different ways of being allowed to be redeemed, Mr. James.
Ms. Shireen, Mr. Chair, members of the committee. Again, both Ms. Klein, who was at the scene and observed what went on, and Supervisor Conks,
who visited with the owner, felt that the owner would comply, and we're allowed to retain their property. And I know that's a rough and harsh way to say it, but by law, it is their property. And they felt they were going to comply, and they have also since communicated with the original complainant that if they see any further violations, to call us, and they're willing to do that. Doesn't say that in your report. I did a follow-up check to see what the status was on this one, and that is what was reported.
So Supervisor Const explained to the Bible dogs he had it, that the dog was found in violation of numerous city of Tucson animal laws. Well, I do not agree in that people like that ever do any better. And I would like to, could we ever have Officer Carr come here? She goes on and on and on about how terrible it all was. She makes a big point of describing everything. Had no shelter to protect him from cold, wind, rain, or heat. I have a hard time really believing that Officer Klein would vote to have that dog left there.
Ms. Shereen, Mr. Chair, members of the committee, are you asking for them to come and discuss on this specific particular case the reason that they felt it was appropriate to redeem, allow the owner to redeem this animal, and then maybe even in general talk to how they go through that process for themselves?
Yes, I think so.
Please.
Okay, and you would like that?
I would.
Ms. Shereen, Ms. Heptich, Mr. Chair, I'm looking at Ms. Horney and Supervisor, or her manager, Jose Chavez, to make sure that's okay for them to come and talk to what they go through in these situations and explain to you how they see it and feel it with their years of experience, looking into these people's faces, looking into the actual scene. And they may not be able to put down all their feelings, inflection, and thoughts as they do it, but keep it clinical and this is evidence that goes to a court of law, so much of that is part and parcel of how they write what they write. So we can certainly ask them to come and share with you these two representing in general what they feel using this case as an example. We can do that.
Ms. Heptich?
I have a question on the same case. How is this animal confined now? Because it says here there is no fencing on the property. How does the owner plan to confine this animal? Is the animal now indoors? Is it taken out on a leash? These are some, I'm like, well, what were the remedies here on some of this?
Ms. Heptich, Mr. Chair, members of the committee, as I mentioned, the owner is, the original complainant is watching for any further violation. They want to know if they see something that doesn't comply with those very things. Staying indoors, on leash when it goes out on with the owner, and or the confinement has been repaired in some other way.
I think by having that discussion with your staff or somebody that is representative of your staff, that the same issue comes up every single month. And we read these, and it's very difficult to read, and we see them, and we wonder how come the dog wasn't impacted, or something like that. It would be really good to get it out on the table as to why not. You know, either it's right or it's wrong, or the reasoning behind it and stuff, and those types of things, because we all keep wondering that every month. We just have never really went out and said a lot about it. So this would be a good idea at this time to talk about why a dog that had no shelter, no water, no, you know, all that type of stuff was redeemed back to that person. So it'd be a good one for someone to explain, at least to the community, I mean, that for the record, why do we do that? Do we not have room at PAC, for example, to impound them? Is it better? Whatever it may be, whatever the answer may be.
And Mr. Chair, as I mentioned, that will happen on the regular. This case will be a separate item on the regular agenda for next meeting with Officer Klein and Supervisor Collins.
Another question about this case.
Yes, ma'am.
You're relying on another community member to call in the complaint after they've made multiple complaints, and to their eyes, the dog's still back with this owner. Are you going to just does Adam going to just rely on a community member to make a complaint, or will there be a visit to check up on this dog? I mean, I think it's a lot to ask for a community member to call and watch this dog. That's not their job. And they've made 4 complaints and still see the dog back with this owner. I give up at that point. I would think that somebody from PAC needs, whether it's Officer Klein or somebody else, needs to make a, you know, surprise visit. I can't say that this should be closed and rely on a neighbor. That's my
opinion. Dr. Smith, Mr. Newman, members of the committee, wholeheartedly agree that it would be much preferable. Let me restart that over. I hear your request, and obviously an approach to take to have some enforcement, recheck as many of these that I'm sure there's some on their list that they'd love to recheck and go back to. In fact, I'm not sure. I know it because I've heard them. I've been in their meeting. I've listened to what they say. But they're sitting there with several thousand that we don't get to yet, and they got priorities even higher above this that they have to do. Mr. Chavez is here today. He's heard your request, and I will reiterate with him that you will return to them. But in this very case, I knew this was going to be the question. I asked the very same question. And up to this point, the staff had received a commitment from this plan that they would let us know if they see anything else. And as a general rule, the only way we find out about any of these at any time is through complaints. We are a complaint-driven organization. So we are driven by that, but we hear you loud and clear that this is your special interest, has our special interest. And we'll go from there. We will hear from these 2 officers next week, next month.
May I just ask one thing? You made a comment. There are 1,000 cases that we haven't gotten to yet. Is that a documented number that we need, that we've got turned down to get 4 more officers? And we have 1,000 cases that haven't been taken care of?
Dr. Smith, Mr. Chairman of the committee, that absolutely is. It's a documented fact that we do not get to all the calls we receive. And that is what we based number 4 on how many we're not able to get.
Let alone go back and check.
Yes, sir.
All the more reason for the request, and then it was denied, nicely denied, but nonetheless denied. But that's not the end of it. So we'll be putting that back on the agenda for the next meeting. And the reason why so that the committee understands, I had the request for the additional staffing for PAC, and I didn't do it because something came up. The change, the dynamics of it, so I'll be rewriting that again. And so even though we were turned down for 4, the idea is we'll be still asking for more, not just the 4. So,
What do you mean, not just 4?
There was 4 additional enforcement that we requested as a committee.
Right.
And we have looked at the staffing that PAC presently has in comparison to what they actually need and in comparison to other
agencies.
And so we've come up with a number as well. We'll still be asking for that too. All right.
No matter what Mr. Huckleberry says, the supervisors could vote more money to hire more field officers.
Okay. Yes. Yes, Mr. James.
Ms. Shereen and Mr. Chair, a member of the committee, that is true. However, our funders, the cities and towns of this community, are not on board with that yet. So we have also will continue to work with them to come on board with all these requests. They are aware of the request for 4 more officers. and they're not necessarily in agreement with that at this point. So there's a lot of work to do on this in general.
Ms. Schroeder.
This has been an ongoing problem about the shortage of field officers. I remember years ago we tried to get my field officer fired, and I fancy correct me if I'm wrong, somebody who's been there a long time. As I recall, we have fewer field officers right now than we did have 10 or 15 years ago. Is that correct, Mr. James?
Ms. Shereen, Mr. Newman, members of the committee, I'm going to have to look into that. In my time here, I don't recall ever going backwards on field officers. But we certainly, because in relation to per capita, we're way shorter than we ever have. Physical numbers, I believe, are the same. But again, I've been here almost 19 years now, a long time.
We're still on the topic of welfare report. Do you have any more comments on those? No? Is anybody? No? All right, then we'll move on to the dangerous animal cases for the month of November. Any commentaries on that? No? All right, we'll move on to the donations. Mr. James, would you like to let us know?
Mr. Chair, members of the committee, we continue to receive numerous donations every month, and it's not just in dollars and cents. We receive many donations in kind and equipment, food, blankets, just many, many things. It's a wonderful. Asset, and it's a wonderful thing for the center. So this month of November, we received another $33,700 in cash donations, various donations, many are individual donors, in conjunction with license renewals. It's also a few donations from larger corporations that want to help us with special events, which we know. So the year to date is higher than it's ever been this time, over 200,000 year to date, when it's never been as high before through November in the past. So we continue to receive numerous donations, and we'll continue to work on that. Our fund development staff member is doing a good job. We continue to receive many, many opportunities, and we'll take advantage of everyone that we can. And I move that. Just as a note, one of those is we have an opportunity to receive several pallets of dog food donated by PetSmart Charities. We're looking for a way to make that happen logistically. We have to come up with a warehouse sufficient to hold hundreds of pallets of dog food. So I'm going to take advantage of it and make every effort to make that happen. And that's been affirmed yet, as far as I know, but it's still on the table, and we're going to work to make that happen.
And that's a budgetary.
And it definitely impacts the budget.
Sure.
Donated food, less money we have to spend on that, and more on how offset the expenses of medication. And
did you give the amount for the month?
$33,700.
That must have been
$33,700, I actually said. Yes, sir.
Thank you. Ms. Hubbard?
Yeah, I have a question for you, Mr. James. Do you have to record in-kind donations? Do you have to give them a value and turn it into the people that count the money?
We do not have to do that for as far as the county accountability.
Okay, I was wondering, we have to do that with
If the donor would like that, we certainly provide that to them, but we don't do it for.
So your budget would not include or your donations would not include any of the in-kind value of the in-kind donations?
Not a cash value.
Thank you.
That question leads me to the last time we spoke about when individuals actually select what they're going to give the money to, and a long time ago, and Ms. Goddard also was talking to me about the SAMS fund, and we were going to change that because most people didn't know what SAMS fund was. We're going to talk about that's the medical or the money rather than Sam's fund? On the document.
I think it is here.
Is it in here? Do you change this?
Mr. Chair, it has been changed on all the advertising, it has not been changed on this document, and it will be.
Great.
My apologies, thank you.
Okay, with that, we have the last call to the audience. If you choose to speak, please fill out a form. I'm not sure if these forms were.
Those spoke during the meeting.
These spoke during.
Those were in line with your question.
Okay.
And of course.
Are there any more individuals that would like to speak to the last call? Okay, with that, the any announcements, schedules, and or proposed agenda items?
Just to say that, I think we have someone who wants to speak.
We skipped over complaints and commendations.
Okay, there were three complaints and no commendations received by the staff during the webinar.
Well, I had a comment about one of these complaints. It's the third one. It's mentioned at length on page 79. Anyway, it's the third complaint. About this man and his wife came out to the animal control, animal care center, I mean, to rescue a dog that, according to Craigslist, it was going to be euthanized very soon. And these people thought they could not adopt the dog, but they still wanted to help somehow. So they came out to the animal care center and offered to donate, here it says, a substantial sum of money to help this animal one way or the other. And they say they got no cooperation at all from the from both the adoption coordinator and the rescue coordinator. They named the name Michelle Lindorf, the rescue coordinator, and Ellie Baldwin, the adoption coordinator, who just dismissed them. They said, oh, we don't do that. Just waved them off very dismissively and just essentially told them to go away and don't bother them. And these people who had come out to donate the large, they say, substantial sum of money, are saying that these people didn't, in their opinion, they didn't care about adoptions or helping the animals. These people wound up, because Kim Silver was there and spoke up in favor of the dog and said it wasn't really, didn't really have all the bad characteristics, it was really a very lovely dog. So this couple wound up adopting the dog in the end. So the story had a happy ending. But what about the fact that they said the adoption coordinator and rescue coordinator had no interest in the matter? Does anybody have any comments?
I do.
Mr. James.
Ms. Shereen, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, that is exactly part and parcel of the discussion and the subcommittee you set up for the record.
I've read this. This is part of the packet that was submitted by the rescue group, so this isn't new to me. I've already seen this. And it is something that, of course, in a meeting that you could discuss as to what actually happened, what didn't happen, or whatever, then move on from there as to the types of things we should be doing. So if something like that were true, then of course that would be a shame. But I think right now what we're trying to do is get over that issue, even if it didn't happen, that we could then, within this committee, move forward and start dealing with issues that we now have.
On this committee that you're coming up, if supposing another committee member wishes to come and just attend the meeting, we can't just bring us to full quorum on it.
Mm-hmm.
Well, if I'm on it and
So another committee member can't just come in, observe, or whatever.
The quorum is what?
Four.
Five.
Five.
So we can have four.
Mr. Chair, as I understand, this is not a subcommittee. This is a focus group that you're helping facilitating, addressing this issue with staff working volunteers. So as this is not a subcommittee, as long as you have less than five members there, we don't have to announce the meeting. If you have five members, we'll just announce it as a meeting and
we just
everybody can go. So that's my point.
I just want to make sure that if I'd like to know when the meetings are, but I don't want to come up against the quorum issue.
Quorum would be five.
Okay. Yeah, I got it on the where's my agenda? All right, so we have the following items. Okay, we're at announcements scheduled and proposed agenda items. Mr. Jane.
Mr. Chair, members of the committee, just wanted to point your attention to an email that was sent out a day or two ago in relation to upcoming events for the Pima Alliance for Animal Welfare. One of them is a cat trapping animal defense league of Arizona presentation on Saturday, January 10th from 1 to 3 at the Community Foundation for Southern Arizona. Ms. Sharina has provided a copy in your packet for you of the announcement itself. There are others on the back table for anybody that would like to get some. We can provide more if necessary. To invite all those that are interested in TNR type of any kind of cat trapping in general. And then there's also an announcement of the Pima Alliance for Animal Welfare's semi-annual community meeting on Friday, January 16th from 8 a.m. until noon, right here in the Abrams Public Health Building. It will be in these rooms on the first floor here. And invite anyone who would like to join us, join the PAW committee, PAW in that meeting on the 16th of January. So those are two events that are coming up.
Mr. Jacobs, may I ask that we get the review of the tech fever treatment policy? We had a presentation, but I don't know what the policy is, and you couldn't discuss it, so it could be out on the agenda so we at least know what it is.
Absolutely.
And secondly, can we ask the members of the public if they have a written report to provide it to us? Zoom regarding the data review. I tried my canvas to follow it, but it would be helpful to get his comments in writing so I might have a better understanding of what he said. Thank
you.
Can I amend Mr. Jacobs' request with his permission that I would like to know the medication policy for all the animals, whether it's treating for Ehrlichia or something else? Because you may be treating for, I don't know, valley fever or something else that, what the length of time is for an animal in care. So.
I have no objection, Chairman, but my specific question was discussion regarding
tick fever.
why it was discontinued. And so I was approaching on that very narrow ground to present to it. The one who wants to review the medical treatment of all the animals, that's fine with me. That's why I'm here.
Okay. Understood.
Could I have a point of personal privilege?
Yes, sir.
To go back to Sam's fund?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Not that I would change it, but Dr. Sam was the first veterinarian to be hired by the University Medical Center. And he personally came in and triaged the animals and at the care center, I think back in the early 60s. And that's why it was named the Sam's Fund. And although I don't remember his entire name, or Hodgkins. Yeah. But Sam did a lot of work and started a fund which we now are able to fund out in another manner. But sometimes we miss and lose the color and path by changing things. Sam was a great man. Thank you.
Thanks for letting me know. I didn't know what Sam was. Okay, with that, the next meeting is January 15th. I'd like to ask if there are any, well, I know a lot of people cleared out, if there are any of the individuals would like to have the meeting here, if we're going to have a lot of participation from individuals out there, we can ask, request that we have this room for the next time, or we can have it at back. So, if you have a raise of hands of the people that will be coming to the next meeting. So with that in mind, I would like to put in a request that we can have this next time.
We'll verify that the room is available, more likely it is, and make sure that, if not this one, there are plenty of rooms here that this is yet to be done.
Yeah, I saw Dr. Garcia's office, maybe we can have it there, is that
good? Not there.
All right, let's see. With that,